The Beatles produced some of the best and most memorable music of the 1960s. It was recorded on the highest quality recording equipment of the day, in the best studios in the world. But by the time it found its way onto vinyl, its sound had changed. The sound quality of original Beatles records varies greatly throughout the world, from the lo-fi pressings of the Far East to the beefed-up, reverb-laden mixes of the early American albums, to the more clinical, clean-cut pressings of Germany and Japan. The same album pressed in different countries can sound worlds apart, and finding out the best-sounding pressing of your favourite album can be a risky, time-consuming and expensive endeavour. I'm Andrew from Parlogram Auctions, and in this, the first of two videos, I'll help you through this minefield and tell you what I think are the 10 best-sounding Beatles records to collect in 2022. Everyone has their own favourite Beatles album. It could be the first one they heard, or the first one they bought. It may be the one which reminds them of a certain person, or a special place or moment in their life. But sound quality is another matter, and although also subjective, is a little more fact-based. Of course, everyone's setup and the way they listen to music is different, but there's a baseline principle in sound reproduction, which is if you put rubbish in, you get rubbish out. So the sound of the music recorded on this isn't the same as what ends up on this. The music on this tape has such a wide dynamic range that if cut flat would cause the stylus to literally jump out of the groove. So to protect against those undesirable occurrences, specialist limiters and compressors were developed by record companies especially for record cutting. Each studio and indeed each country had its own way of mastering, which is why this disc sounds completely different to this disc. In the same way, if I was to use the video straight out of the camera, it would look something like this. Kind of flat and dull looking. If I then gave it to different editors all around the world to grade, all would end up looking different. So it could go from this, to this, and even this. In the late 1950s, EMI reserved its best quality recording and mastering for its classical product. For example, these early stereo reel-to-reel tapes of classical music were copied one-to-one in real time from the master tape and cost the equivalent of £100 or $130 today. Pop, however, was a very different matter. Engineers cutting pop records were under instruction to make them sound as loud as possible and pay little attention to sound quality. After all, these records would be played on reproducers which were often little more than toys. The main cutting engineers in charge of cutting Beatles records were Harry Moss at Abbey Road and later Malcolm Davis at Apple, and they set the standard by which the Beatles sound is measured today. Now I'm not, or at least don't consider myself to be, an audiophile. I just like good sounding copies of my favourite records. And finding a well-mastered quality pressing can take your listening enjoyment to a different level. Now some of the albums on this list might not be yours or even my favourites. These albums are not here purely on artistic content, but they are ones which I think will give you the best sounding Beatles experience. So, what makes me an expert? Well, I've been listening to Beatles records for most of my life, and I've spent the past 25 years selling pressings from all over the world and listening to them too. So I'm pretty confident I know what I'm talking about. But of course, if you have another opinion, do let me know in the comments. Now, of course, I can't play any of them to you here. But that's not the point. This is a discussion to which you're welcome to contribute to in the comments. So with all that out of the way, let's get into it. Normally when it comes to good sound quality, most people think of albums, but not these. But there are some Beatles 45s which sound, for one reason or another, best on that format. Although not high on many people's lists of their top 10 favourite Beatles songs, this pressing is here mainly due to its sound quality. I discussed the history of this 45 in a previous video on this channel, but if you haven't seen that, here's a quick recap. Love Me Do was originally recorded at Abbey Road on September the 4th, 1962, with Ringo on drums. It was then re-recorded on September the 11th with session musician Andy White on drums, and Ringo was relegated to tambourine duty. And it's that September the 11th remake version which appeared on the Please Please Me album and Beatles Hits EP, and all subsequent pressings available today. The so-called Ringo on drums version was only available in the UK on this original Red Label 45, and then on Black Label copies up until the end of 1964, when it was deleted. Since the master tape was junked in 1963, subsequent reissues of the track, like on the 1982 12-inch, and the 2012 50th anniversary 45, and the 2019 singles box, have all been sourced from an original copy of the disc, with varying degrees of success. But none of them match the warmth and presence of the original UK 45. The richness of the bass and overall tonality and clarity of the sound on this disc is in complete contrast to the remake, which although is a better performance of the song, just doesn't sound anywhere near as good. Although the single in the 2019 box set comes out closest to all of the reissues, it's still missing the depth and sparkle of the first pressing. A mint copy of the first pressing will set you back a few hundred, but I think its sound will surprise you and maybe change your mind about this song. This year, 2022, is the 60th anniversary of this disc, so I'll be interested to see what Apple comes up with for that. Number 9 takes us even further back in time than Love Me Do, to the Hamburg recordings in fact, and this album, the early Beatles. Although the Beatles only take the lead on 4 tracks on this album, those 4 are worth the price of entry alone. All of the recordings the Beatles made at Abbey Road were of excellent quality, but the dynamics of the sound never seemed to make their way onto the final record. But that was a different story with the Polydor recordings. On June the 22nd, 1961, the Beatles, or the Beat Brothers as they were billed, recorded 7 tracks in a sports hall at the Friedrich Ebert Halle in Hamburg. Those tracks were My Bonnie, The Saints, Why, Cry for a Shadow, Nobody's Child, Ain't She Sweet, and Take Out Some Insurance on Me Baby. Recorded on quarter-inch tape running at 15 inches per second on a Telefunken M5 two-track tape recorder, the Polydor engineers utilised 5 high-quality Neumann U47 microphones, with a Neumann SM2 for the drums. The man in charge that day was the legendary German bandleader Bert Kampfert, whose own records don't sound bad either. Everything was recorded live in stereo, with the microphones plugged directly into the desk. There was no PA system or any way of separating the musicians on stage, which led to the sound from one microphone bleeding into another. And it's that combination of quality equipment, sound leakage, and great playing by the Beatles which gives these recordings their wonderful sound. The unique Lennon-Harrison composition Cry for a Shadow is a highlight of this album. It has the deepest and best recorded bass sound of any Beatles recording, even Baby You're a Rich Man. These recordings have been made available many times over the years, and are also the cheapest and easiest to find of all the records on this list. This 1971 pressing on Polydor's budget label, Contour, is superb, with the earliest copies using the same stampers as the 1967 Polydor album, Beatles First. You can forget the dreaded wording which proclaims that these are mono recordings, electrically reprocessed to give a stereo effect on stereo equipment. These are all in fact true stereo recordings, with not a hint of reprocessing in sight. Although being recut and repackaged on the even more budget Pickwick label, in this typical 1970s cover, it sounds just as good. Best of all is that you can pick it up for literally just a couple of pounds or dollars, and it's guaranteed to put a huge smile on your face. Staying with the collection theme, if you want the best sounding Abbey Road recordings, look no further than the original UK 1973 first pressings of 1962 to 1966 and 1967 to 70, otherwise known as the Red and the Blue albums. Alan Klein was the driving force behind this double album set, which was the first major retrospective of the Beatles catalogue. Compiled by staffers at Klein's company, the albums featured most of their best-known tracks and was issued worldwide in April 1973. For the UK issue, EMI were careful to source the tracks from the original master tapes and those transfers can be seen logged on the original tape boxes. For example, here's the tape box of side 2 of Beatles for Sale, from which they took 8 days a week. As you might be able to see, the copy date, written in red ink, is the 21st of March 1973, followed by B1, which means Band 1, and then 4 Beatles Package, which was the red album. For the US release, Capitol used whatever tapes they had lying around, and that version comes nowhere near this list. Although most UK pressings of this album are consistently good, the earliest pre-1974 ones are best. Why? Well, the 1974 oil crisis led to a shortage and rise in price of vinyl's main ingredient, PVC. So in order to save money, EMI began using extender resins, or fillers, which led to a poorer grade of vinyl in the years which followed. Copies are, of course, everywhere, but they're getting harder to find in top condition. So if you can't be bothered with that, go straight to the 2014 reissues, which were both cut from the album's original analogue tapes and sound just as fantastic. But make sure to get copies which they pressed in the EU on the sticker. The Made in Canada ones are not as good and were sourced from different tapes. Despite being a big success on its release in the US in October 1969, this album was completely ignored by EMI and didn't receive a domestic release until May 1979. This was Alan Klein's first contribution to the Beatles' legacy, and basically mopped up tracks which hadn't been included up to that point on any Capitol album. Although an effort was made to obtain true stereo mixes of every track, the album sounded pretty lifeless. However, EMI couldn't ignore its popularity completely, and demand in some territories, such as Scandinavia, forced them to produce a pressing at their UK factory for export. As with the three early US albums, Hey Jude was issued as part of their CPCS export series. But unlike their earlier US export albums, which used tapes imported from Capitol, EMI compiled their album from tapes from their own library, which gave a much better quality of sound. CPCS 106 was first issued in 1971 and came on the dark green Apple label, complete with a couple of typos, such as Paper Backwriter and Revolutions. However, these were corrected when it was repressed in 1973 on a lighter green Apple label. The album was eventually given a UK domestic release in May 1979, but like Magical Mystery Tour a few years earlier, was cut from a copy of Capitol's tape and didn't sound anywhere near as good. Both light and dark Apple label pressings of this album carry, in my opinion, the best sounding stereo sources for all of the tracks on this LP. So if you love this album, do yourself a favour and hunt this one down. The Please Please Me LP was not issued in Germany at the same time as the UK release. With the Beatles had been the Germans' introduction to the group in November 1963. The album eventually appeared in February 1964 on the Hört zu label. Hört zu, which translates from German as listen, was and still is Germany's top TV listings magazine. They had an arrangement with Electrola to issue albums using their brand name, of which this was the first by the Beatles. This was also the label on which Help, Revolver and Sgt. Pepper first appeared on in that country. The 1964 pressing is very flat and lifeless, just like the original German with the Beatles. However, it was transformed in a late 1960s cutting, probably from a different tape, which resulted in the finest sounding stereo pressing of this album ever. This outstanding cutting can be found not only on this red label issue, but also the mid to late 70s Apple label pressings, which was housed in the more familiar cover. The crucial detail is that both carry the A2, B2 matrix. The sound on this pressing is super clean and clear, and unlike the UK pressing, sounds totally uncompressed. It really breathes and is a wonderful listening experience. Unfortunately, that's all we've got time for in this episode, but I hope you'll join me next week for part 2 when I'll reveal my top 5 best sounding Beatles vinyl albums. Meantime, why not visit our website parlogramauctions.com, where you can find lots of great sounding Beatles vinyl. But that's all for this one, so I'll say bye for now and thanks for watching.